So before we start, I want everyone to do me a favor, close your eyes. Now as you close your eyes, I want you to think of one person that you know that doesn't know the Lord. I want you to think of one person that you know for a fact isn't saved. And I want you to think of the person that you love so much you want to see them saved more than you want to see anything else in this world happen. Once you think that person, you have that person in your brain, I want you to open your eyes. Everyone got it? Okay. So over the last few weeks, we've been learning about spiritual gifts and what our calling is for the body of Christ. As all who are saved by Christ are called to serve the body of Christ. So that leads us to what our message is today, a call that you are called to. A call that every single one of y'all are called to. We all have one calling in common, and we're going to learn exactly what that calling is today. So you don't have to turn there, but let's look at Ephesians chapter 4. We're going to be looking at verses 11 through 12. The Word of God says, "And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and the teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ." So God gave some people different callings in leadership. For me, he called me to be a youth pastor. Sean, he called to be the pastor. A lot of y'all, he called to be deacons. Some of y'all that are in here, he called to be Sunday school teachers. He called us to the position of leadership, but the position of leadership isn't us doing the ministry by ourselves. Couldn't stress it more enough. It's not my job because I'm on staff to go win people to Christ. It's not, I mean, it is my job as a Christian, but it's not my job alone. It's every single one of your jobs. It is the calling for us not only to do the ministry ourselves, but equip the saints for the work of the ministry. Does anyone know who the saints are?
Us.
The saints are y'all. Anyone that's accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior is a saint. And therefore, as a saint, you're called to do the work of the ministry. So we're going to be learning today exactly what the work of the ministry is that we're supposed to equip you to do. We're going to be learning exactly what God has called every single one of y'all to do in order to propel, to prosper this gospel. So some of y'all might be thinking, not that good at witnessing. It's a little awkward. I don't like talking to people. I'm shy. It's really even awkward to talk about people, about Jesus and salvation. You know the world we live in. People don't like to talk about that. People get mad. Don't talk about religion, politics. And yeah, you might not be comfortable with it. A little secret to tell y'all. Sometimes it's even a little nerve-wracking for me. I've been doing it for years. It's nervous talking to people. And it's okay to be nervous. It's okay to not be comfortable with it. But it's not okay not to do it. And you might be thinking, though, but Josh, it says right there in verse 11, "And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and the teachers." It says right there that he gave the evangelists. So why do I have to do the work of an evangelist? What makes me called to go witness to people? What makes me called to go spread his word? If it says he gave the evangelists, if I'm not comfortable with it, what makes me called? Well, we're going to be learning today that there's a difference between an being called to be an evangelist and being called to evangelism. If that's what you were thinking, well, I'm not called to be an evangelist, you might be right. Most of y'all aren't called to be evangelists. But you don't have to be an evangelist to do evangelism. Because all are called to do evangelism. There's a clear difference in that call. If you think about it right here, the most famous evangelist of our time, maybe the teens, it's a little old for y'all, but Billy Graham, right? Y'all think of him. Replace the word evangelist with Billy Graham in that. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the Billy Grahams, the teachers, the shepherds, and the teachers. And so, therefore, there is a difference in that calling. There is a difference in the calling of Billy Graham and the calling of us. None of y'all are going to be Billy Graham. First of all of y'all are way better looking than Billy Graham, number one. Number two, no, not all of us have the natural God-given gift that Billy Graham has to speak to crowds of thousands and lead them to the Lord. But if you're saved, you have the Holy Spirit inside of you. You have Jesus Christ truly living in your heart. You have Jesus Christ truly living in your heart. That's all you need. That is all you need to witness to someone. That is all you need to tell people. It's the gospel. Doesn't have to be in masses, but you're called to tell people about the gospel of Jesus Christ. So, this is a calling that we all share. Well, how do we know that? God made that clear. Jesus made that clear in his final commandment that he gave the disciples before he ascended into heaven. While everything that Jesus said is important, every single word in this book is important. It's the inspired, infallible, perfect word of God. While every single thing he said is important, wouldn't y'all think the thing that he emphasized, the very last thing he ever said, as this is the last time he appeared to all the disciples before he ascended to heaven. After this, he only appeared once more in form, and that was the Saul of Tarsus on Damascus Road. But the last time he appears to the masses of his followers, what do y'all think he's going to stress? What he believes is most important, or something that he thinks is just as important as everything else? What do y'all think? Most important? He's going to stress what's most important, right? Well, let's look real quick. Again, don't have to turn there. It'll be on the screen, but let's look at Mark 16:15 and Acts 1:8. And these were his final commandments. Mark 16:15, it says, and he said to them, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. He said to them, go, proclaim the gospel, proclaim the truth, proclaim the salvation that you have in me to the rest of the world. Does that mean that every single one of y'all are called to go around the whole world? Every single one of y'all are called to go to Africa, Asia, the uttermost parts of the world, as it's to the ends of the earth, or to the ends of the earth, as it says in Acts 1:8? No. But you're called to go to your neighbors. You're called to go to the people of the town that God's called you to live in. You're called to witness to them. You know, you might be the only light that they ever see to Jesus Christ. You may be the only example that they ever see to Jesus Christ. But we can't do it ourselves, as we see in Acts 1:8. Right before Jesus ascended, he told all the disciples to stay put until he received the Spirit. And the reason he did that was because, yeah, can you witness without the Holy Spirit? Sure. People do it. Is it as powerful? No. There's power in the Word of God. If you witness the Word of God, there's going to be power in it. But the Holy Spirit gives you the words to say. The Holy Spirit gives you the power. The Holy Spirit gives you the courage, the strength, to tell other people about Jesus. Gives you sometimes the words to say when you don't know what to say. Gives you the ability to relate to other people in a way that you might not have known to relate to other people. It's that power that leads people to work. Let me make this clear, and I can't make this abundantly clear enough. I have never led someone to the Lord. Y'all have never led someone to the Lord. It's always been the Holy Spirit working within me. It's not me. It's Him working within me. So in Acts 1:8 we see, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witness in Jerusalem, in Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Well, now in America, we're part of the ends of the earth. And we're called to be that witness. We don't have to wait for the Holy Spirit, because the second we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we receive it. And the second you receive it, we are to be His witness to anywhere that God's called us to. To Seneca, South Carolina, to Oconee County, to South Carolina as a whole. Wherever you go, when you're on vacation, you're called to be that witness with the power of the Holy Spirit. So therefore, that leads us to our first point today, our primary goal. What should be our primary goal? What should be our primary goal in Christ? It's the primary goal that He has given us. It's the primary goal of winning the lost for Him. It's the primary goal of His Great Commission. But how important, this is our primary goal, how important should it be to us? How much should we be willing to sacrifice through the power of the Holy Spirit in order to see even just one person get saved? In order to see it, how much should we be willing to sacrifice? Pastor I grew up with always had a saying, it's worth it all for just one soul. It's worth it all for just one soul. I'm going to challenge y'all to have that mentality today. That's the mentality that Jesus had. That's the mentality that Paul had. And that's the mentality that Christ wants us to have. That it's worth sacrificing everything for just one soul. All right, everybody, now you can turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. This is the main text we're going to be in. And we will start reading in verse 19. For though I am free from all, I've made myself a servant to all, that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became a Jew in order to win Jews. To those outside the law, to those under the law, I became as one under the law, though not being myself under the law, that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, not being outside the law of God, but being under the law of Christ, that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, that I might share with them in its blessings. You see, right here, Paul willingly clearly states that he's willing to sacrifice anything and become anything in order to see people get saved. He is willing to go to the outermost parts of the world. He's willing to go through any trial. He's willing to become anything to anybody in order to see them get saved. He wanted to see as many people get saved as he possibly could. Saved through Christ, saved through the power of the Holy Spirit walking through him. But he was not only willing to go to them, it says right here, he was willing to become them. Let's look back at verse 20. And it says in verse 20, to the Jews, I became a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though not being myself under the law, that I might win those under the law. So, right there, he was willing to become a Jew. He was willing to become like a Jew. He was willing to sacrifice his freedom. Jews were distinguished from the rest of the people as, if you know, in the Old Testament, they were given a Levitical law, the law of Moses, the Mosaic law. And they were to live by that law because Christ had not come yet and God wanted them to be separate of the other people. But Christ was the release from these chains. Levitical laws, like chains to the ground, something you can't escape because it's something you can never perfectly hold. But the Jews were still bound to this. They still felt bound to this because they did not accept Jesus Christ as, Lord, as their Lord and Savior. The second Paul accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior, them chains went away. But he's saying right here, when he says, to the Jews I became a Jew in order to win the Jews, to those under the law I became as one under the law, to win those under the law, he's saying he's willing to put them chains back on. He's willing to go back for a time to the slavery in which he was in, the slavery to the law, in order to win some people to Christ. So some of the Levitical laws, can't eat pork, shrimp, can't wear material, wear woven out of two different materials, so I guess my shirt's off limits today. Can't do a lot. And Paul was finally able to do these things. But Paul was willing to sacrifice that because of the gospel. That meant Paul couldn't eat pork for a while. That's what that meant. Paul couldn't eat pork for a while. If Paul had to do sacrifices in order to relate to them, as you see in Acts, he did sacrifices. He was completely dedicated to God, but willing to act as one under the law in order to relate to other people, to witness to them, to give them the gospel of Jesus Christ. It'd be like if you went to a Jew or a Muslim today. Would witnessing to a Muslim be throwing a piece of bacon in their face, no matter how good it is, eating it right in front of them, and just being like, sorry, I'm allowed to do this, I don't care what you say. No, you're going to go to their culture, you're going to go to their way. You're going to sacrifice your freedom in order to see them get saved. Why would you do that? Why would anybody do this? The reason's clear. The only reason anybody would do this is to see them get saved, to relate. Then you see in verse 21, to those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, not being outside the law of God, but under the law of Christ, that I might win those outside the law. So right there, he was willing to sacrifice his comfort. He was willing to sacrifice every preference he had in order to see people get saved. He was willing to go to any bounds, willing to go to sinners, willing to go to the most wicked parts of the world, and do anything except for sin, except for break the law of Christ, in order to see people get saved. That's like our Bikers for Christ. Real quick, I want to commend y'all. One thing that I found out as soon as I came to this church is the work that the Bikers for Christ are doing. And they are going to the people that Paul's talking about right now, to those outside the law. They're the most wicked of wicked, the most sinner of sinners, and the Bikers for Christ are going to the Hell's Angels clubhouses, building relationships, loving on them, and they're doing this all, putting themselves in these situations, not sinning themselves, but putting themselves in these situations to see some of them get saved. The whole purpose of it is to see people get saved. They're going to these people that have known nothing but dirt, leather, drugs, and hardship, alcohol, you name it, their entire life. People that many people for years wouldn't be willing to go to. Many people for years, oh, they're sinners, gotta stay away. Stay away from the sin. Don't stay away from the sinner. And that's what they're willing to do. They are willing to sacrifice that comfort. Do you think it's comfortable for them? No. Christian, it has to grieve you being in that situation. But they do it in order to prosper the cause of Jesus Christ. And it's not easy for them either, in the sense they get judgment for it. Jesus got judgment for it, though. You look right now at Luke chapter 5. I'm going to be reading verses 29 through 32. Again, it'll be on the screen. Stay in 1 Corinthians. And it says right here, and Levi made him a great feast in his house. And there was a large company of tax collectors and others reclining at the table with them. And the Pharisees and their scribes grumbled at his disciples, saying, why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? And Jesus answered them, those who are well have no need for a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinners to repent. If you look back at verse 30, where it says, and the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled at his disciples, saying, why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? Right there. That was probably, if you understand the time, that was the worst judgment he could have possibly received. Jews were told to stay away from them people. They were separate from them people. Jesus went to them people. Right there, they are completely calling to question everything about his testimony. They are completely calling to question everything that makes Jesus Lord. They are calling to question his righteousness. They're saying, see, he's not righteous. He's not perfect. He's not the Messiah. He eats with tax collectors and sinners. The people he came to save, he came to save the world, but the people he was the king of the Jews, was being judged by his own people. The people that were supposedly waiting for the Messiah since the beginning of time, since Adam and Eve fell, have been waiting for the Messiah, were judging him. And I know by grace for Christ, it probably faced some of that judgment, so I commend you all for that, because people have probably said, what are you doing? That's not Christian. That's not right. You're going in these situations. But what does Paul say? To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law in order to win those outside the law. He was willing to sacrifice anything except for sin, except for go against God. And that's what they're willing to do. And that's what I want to challenge all of y'all to do today. Be willing to break them comfort zones. It's for the cause of Jesus Christ. It's for the cause of the gospel. It's for the gospel mission. And it has to be something we're willing to do. So this is our mission. Become all these things for all these people in order to win some. I know some of y'all might be thinking, it's a misconception that I believe most of my life, but we're in the Bible Belt. We're in the Bible Belt. Everybody's saved in the Bible Belt. You go to Walmart and you stand outside of Walmart and if you ask 100 people that walk in, do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Do you believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins, living the perfect life you couldn't live, rose again to defeat that death? I would bet you 90 to 95 of them would say yes. That's not the truth. That's not the truth of the country we live in. That leads us to where we are in America. Right now, this is, according to Pew Research Center, which is basically some of the, some people might know, the Nielsen rating system for TV. It's basically the same thing for the church. According to this, 70.6% of America claims to be Christian. But only 25.4% claim to be a born, claim to believe in a born-again salvation through faith and repentance. Only 25.4% claim to be a born-again Christian. So right there, very first step, 70.6%. That means 29.4% of America is headed straight to hell right there. Right there, 29.4%. That means 3 out of every 10 people in America right now, just by that stat, going to hell. If you think about it, just look around you. Look at 10 people around you. If this represented all of America, at least 3 would be going to hell. And it should grieve us if even one soul goes to hell. Which they are, and God says, the path to righteousness is narrow, you will find it. But it still ought to grieve us. We ought to think about hell with a tear in our eye. Not fear in our heart, because we know we're not going there. But a tear in our eye. Because right there, 29.4% of America is automatically not safe. And then, if you look at the other 45.2%, that's the percent between the 70.6% of America that claims to be Christian and the 25.4% that claim to be evangelical, to believe in a born-again salvation through faith and repentance. They go to churches that teach salvation by other means. They might go to a church that teaches salvation through baptism, which we know baptism doesn't save. Baptism proclaims salvation. It's like wearing a wedding ring. It doesn't make you married, but you're already married, and the wedding ring proclaims you're married. It proclaims your salvation, but it doesn't make you saved. Baptism through the sacraments. Just took the Lord's Supper last week, and some people believe that saves us. No salvation in the Lord's Supper. Or works. Some of them teach faith plus works equals salvation. But you can't be saved unless you have works. You need to have faith and works, which is not relying on Christ alone, which means you can't have salvation. Now, I'm not saying that none of that 45.2% are saved. I know many of them that are. I still go to them churches, but still believe in a born-again salvation through faith and repentance. But let me make this clear today that there is no salvation without faith and repentance. Doesn't exist. There is no way to Jesus Christ without accepting him through faith and truly repenting of our sin. And even the 25.4%. There are many people that go to evangelical churches that have sat in a pew most of their lives, if not their entire lives, and have never taken the step to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. They might have thought praying a prayer, just the simple words of the prayer would do it, but never took the posture, never took the step of faith and dedicating your heart to him, surrendering your heart to him. So, even if you look at that as washout, well, the people that claim to be saved but aren't evangelical, that are truly saved but aren't evangelical, to the people that are born again, that claim to be born again but aren't, even if you count that as a wash, Only 25.4% of our nation is saved. And I'm sure it's even less than that. That means one out of every four people are saved. Let me make this clear. Sin is cancer. It's like a cancer. But it's a cancer with a cure. It's a cancer that is worse than earthly cancer. It doesn't lead to physical death. It leads to spiritual death. But there is a cure. There is a cure in Jesus Christ. According to this, only one in four people, probably less than that, if I had a guess, I would probably say about 15%, have that cure. One in four people have that cure. Let me ask you this. Just say you discovered the cure for cancer, the literal cure for cancer, physical cancer on earth. If you had the cure, would you just hide it to yourself, say it's mine, and go away with it? No. Would anybody do that? No. You would share the cure. You want to see people be well. You have the cure, but you have the cure to eternal cancer. You have the cure to the cancer known as sin. And the cure is Jesus Christ. So are you willing to do what Paul says to do, become to the Jews, I became a Jew in order to win some Jews. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law in order to win those outside the law. Are you willing to sacrifice it all, every comfort, every freedom, everything you have, in order to see some people get saved? That's the mentality we ought to have to see people get saved. That's the heart we should have for the lost. So what are we going to do? So what are we to do? To the Jews, I became a Jew in order to win some Jews. We're to become all things to all people in order some people get saved. I get that, but what are we to do? This leads us to our next point, the second point, which is to keep your eyes on the prize. Keep your eyes on the prize. What is that prize? Let's look back in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, and we'll read verses 24 through 27. Give me a second to get there, in case you turn. Do you not know that in a race, all runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air, but I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. Right here, Paul tells us to run the race so that we may obtain the prize. That means to live a life that is entirely focused on serving God through diligent effort in your life through the work of the Holy Spirit inside of you. That means running toward the lost, running toward the cause of Christ, running toward the gospel mission, running toward prospering Him. Running toward whatever he has called you to do. But that means running a race of self-control and discipline. You see right there, at the end of verse 24. So run that, I'm sorry, in verse 25. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So one must be entirely dedicated to the race in order to win that race. If you're entirely dedicated to the race, you're going to act in self-control. You're going to exercise self-control. So if you're going to exercise self-control, can you go into it unprepared? Let me ask you all this. Could I sit on my butt and eat nothing but McDonald's Big Macs for a year straight, and then go run a marathon and win. Yeah, doesn't work that way, right? What do I have to do to win the marathon? I have to train to win the marathon. I have to prepare myself to win the marathon. And you can't go into the race of winning souls without preparing for the marathon. Verse 27, but I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. You go into the race practice. Well, how do we practice for the spiritual race? Do you never open your Bible? Do you never say a prayer and just go witness to people? No. Is there going to be power in that? No. We have to prepare ourselves. We have to prepare ourselves for the race by studying His Word, by prayer, knowing that we don't do it, but Jesus Christ does it through us, that He is the way. And we have to prepare ourselves to be a vessel unto Him. So this leads us to Philippians 3:12-14. This will be the final passage of the day. It'll be on the screen if you don't want to turn there. And it says, Philippians 3:12-14, not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own. Because Christ Jesus has made me His own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own. But one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. So Paul is straining toward what lies ahead. What lies ahead is clear as day in Philippians 3:14. I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. The upward call for Paul and God in Christ Jesus was to lead people to the Lord, was to see people get saved, was to submit to Him and give it all, give everything, have a single focus on the gospel mission. That upward call is the same upward call that everyone in this room has. Every single person in this room has the upward call of God in Christ Jesus to press toward the goal for the prize. And the prize is winning souls. The prize is serving the Lord in what He has you to do. And every single one of you, He has to win souls. Not only win souls, but to do, not only witness to people, not only tell others about Jesus, but doing whatever it takes in order to lead them to Christ. Doing whatever it takes in order to see that someone get saved. If, again, thinking back to 1 Corinthians 9:19, if that means to the Jews I became a Jew, to those under the law I became as one under the law, that means sacrificing your freedom, you sacrifice your freedom. You sacrifice your freedom for the cause of Christ. That means becoming as one outside the law, to those outside the law. That means going to the sinners, like the Bikers for Christ has done through Hell's Angels and everything. If that means going to those that are clearly living in sin and relating to them, not sinning yourself, but going to build a relationship with them, going to relate to them, going to have them see the gospel light inside of you, it's what you did. You have to have the mentality that you do whatever it takes to see people get saved. So what's our mission? Our mission is clear. Our mission is to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. Our mission is to press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. So we are all called to make the gospel mission our primary focus. Be real with y'all. We live in a country that's dying of cancer. The cancer of sin. We live, probably many of y'all have family that had this cancer, that had the cancer of sin. You have the cure. You have the cure in Jesus Christ. So what are you going to do with it? What are you going to do with it to share the gospel with that one person that you thought of earlier? Are you going to sacrifice your freedom in order to win them? Or have the opportunity to win them, to relate to them, to have the Holy Spirit work through you in their life? Are you going to sacrifice your preferences and go to the sinners, just like Jesus Christ did when he went to Levi, when he went to Matthew? Just like Bikers for Christ does when they go to Hell's Angels? Are you willing to sacrifice it all, the gospel of Jesus Christ? Are you willing to give it all in order to see one person get saved? And remember, that is our mission. It is worth it all for just one person to get saved. With every head bowed, every eye closed, wonder what steps God's calling you to make today. If you haven't yet accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, it doesn't mean anything for you to share the gospel of Jesus Christ yet. You don't have the upward call of God in Christ Jesus yet. And the truth is, you're dying. You're on your way to hell. But there is a way out of that. And that is through accepting the perfect Savior that already did it for you. If you're not sure that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, all you have to do is trust in Him, in Him alone, that He lived the perfect life that you could never live, that He died the death that you deserve to die, truly taking your place on the cross, on Calvary's mount, and rose again to defeat that death. That you can't do it yourself, that you are just a sinner deserving of hell, but He's already done it for you. And all you have to do is trust Him and give Him control of your heart. That's it. Want to do that? Would you pray a prayer like this today, dear Lord? I know I'm a sinner. I know I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. I know I have the cancer known as sin that is going to lead to spiritual death. And I know that you are the only way. You are the only cure. And I trust you and you alone. I trust in your finished work that you died the death I should have died and rose again to defeat that death. And Lord, today I surrender my life to you. I surrender my heart to you. I give you control of my heart. I'm sorry for my sin, and I give you control. If you're saved, you already know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, why don't you be praying for that one person that you thought of earlier? Be praying for them and be praying for the rest of the lost, knowing that you have to prepare for that. You have to prepare to be a witness. All right, the altar's open.